Good morning, everyone. It's great to see so many of you joining us. This, my name is Isaac Kohane. I'm a professor of biomedical informatics and pediatrics at Harvard Medical School. I'm also the chair of a nonprofit foundation, the I2B2 Transmart Foundation, which is hosting this meeting. And I want to thank Diane Keough and Rudy Punzon for their efforts in bringing this together. So we are, I'd like to bring us back to beginning of March 2020. It, by the first week of March 2020, anybody who was looking at the news and at reports from Europe knew we were in for a potentially very serious pandemic. And so in that first week, I sent out emails to colleagues across the globe saying, you know, I suspect that it's going to be a while before we see systematic analyses of the clinical care of these patients because it just takes a lot more effort when you try to do it, let's say, as a governmentally sponsored project. And that we have a community here that can get going right away. And I was gratified to see that we were able to get together in, within that first week, a group of over 110 hospitals across five countries. Now, since then, we've, our volunteer consortium, 4CE, has expanded to over 300 hospitals and nine countries. But back then, we had, as I said, five countries and about 110 hospitals. And what was quite remarkable is that we completed an analysis of the clinical course of the first weeks of COVID patients within the first 2 to 3 weeks of March, such that by the fourth week of March, we had submitted a preprint to MedArchive, which documented the course of the disease early on, by the way, showing that in the first week, it was clearly visible that patients had a coagulopathy, that patients had a systemic inflammatory reaction that was off the charts, that they had a cardiomyopathy, and that there was a major renal failure component and a hepatic dysfunction component. That was all obvious within the first week. And although the Nature digital medicine paper that was taken from the preprint only was published, I think, 4 or 5 months later, it was quite remarkable to me. I'd never seen something like this, that we could get from no infrastructure, well, no joint infrastructure, to a publication with interesting results at an international level within 4 weeks. And I'd like us to quickly reflect what made this possible. So back in 2004, several of us, like Sean Murphy, myself, and numerous players around Boston, participated in what was called then a RFA for National Centers of Biomedical Computing, NCBCs. And basically, we wrote a grant which said, can we imagine taking our admittedly highly imperfect data, to be generous, from the electronic health record, and use the not only the codified data. At that time, it was a bit of almost iconoclastic thought to say we could use the textual data, the clinical notes. This is back in 2004, with natural language processing to extract phenotypes. Could we join these two genotypes that we would obtain for patients from discarded samples? And could we thereby instrument the healthcare system for discovery? And so we were funded for that, and that resulted in the I2B2 informatics for integrating biology to the bedside, National Center for Biomedical Computing, which was officially funded for 10 years, but because this open source software was adopted by well over 100 academic health centers, led to numerous international collaborations, numerous grants, and then literally hundreds of papers, and the creation of the foundation that is sponsoring this meeting.
Thank you. But there was some...
Hello?
Zach, you have 2 minutes left.
Yep. And so I would like us to reflect why we were successful and what was it about the ITUB experience that made it successful. I think the fact that it was an open source effort with contributions from all the community really cemented, and that we had academic users meetings several times a year, nationally and internationally, really cemented us so that when I made that early email, we could proceed. But also the fact that all these members were expert in their local data systems, in all these very heterogeneous systems, some homegrown, some commercial EHRs, the fact that they were expert in those systems enabled them, when we put out the call, to provide highly robust and sort of skepticism-proof results. And lest we take this for granted, I want to contrast that with publications that appeared, I think, May of 2020 in The Lancet and the New England Journal of Medicine, where a company, Certisphere, working with some colleagues, published a big international study, which if you had looked at the detail and understood how electronic health record systems work, was completely fraudulent. And of course, these papers were ultimately retracted. But my point is, we've created a community, and the 4CE community has expanded to include many other communities that you'll hear about today, such as the ODSI group and the Recover Grant and the N3C consortium. And so I think that if you continue listening to this day and reflect on the fact that we can't take for granted that we have this distributed set of experts who understand their healthcare system, understand the informatics, and are able to provide robust analyses that really kick the tires on the data, its quality, and its interpretation. If you keep that in mind, I think you'll particularly appreciate the rest of this brief conference together. And with that, I will shut off my video and mute myself.
Okay, so we'll turn this over to Griffin and Tianxi.
Thank you so much, Zach, for that great introduction. I'm joined here with Tianxi Kai. I'm Griffin Weber. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our 4CE symposium. Tianxi and I are going to talk about what's called phase one and phase two analyses within 4CE. This is the technical part of the event today. We're sure exactly what we're doing, and then we'll do this fast so we can learn more about the actual results that we've learned through our consortium. So as Zach mentioned in his introduction, there were a lot of different international and national efforts that were launched early last year to study COVID. And as we were looking at these, we realized we really are going to only be able to trust the results of these things if we could trust the data that's being aggregated to do these studies. So we engaged a number of local experts in both informatics, statistics, as well as clinicians across hospitals around the world. Our goals were to look at our data quality, try to improve that, understand the limitations of EHR data when we're studying COVID, and to be able to conduct rapid analyses that includes a patient chart review in a federated way. We thought that early intelligence is worth more than complete intelligence later. So we want to move quickly, publish results, and share our lessons with others. And we were very quickly able to ramp up to hundreds of hospitals across multiple countries and continents. We have two kinds of analyses in 4C. We call them phase one and phase two. They're not sequential, these two things run in parallel. Both of them use a federated model. That means the analyses are run locally by these experts at their institution, and only aggregate results and statistics are shared centrally. By doing this, we stay close to the data. We always have somebody we can go back to ask questions about the data. Are there data quality problems? Or are there different ways of doing this analysis that will better answer our questions? Local data experts, including the clinicians, help us refine questions, know the coding practices, and actually can go and do chart review if we're not sure about what we're seeing in the EHR data. And because we have people locally and close to the data, we can actually go back and fix problems. If someone's ICD-2 instance, for example, is having an ETL or data loading problem, we can discover that and fix it. Phase one studies, the goal of those is to get a quick global perspective across lots of different kinds of hospitals and patient populations. We're able to reach out to over 300 hospitals. We have 37,000 admitted patients plus a lot more COVID-negative patients and outpatients. We can see regional and country variation. Phase one analyses are just SQL queries that we send out to sites. They run it on their database. About half have ICD-2, and then later on, we've had others that join in with OMOP and other data models. All you're producing are some aggregate count CSV files that get uploaded to a central website. Because it's all aggregate data and you're not removing any patient data from your repositories, there's generally low regulatory barriers to participate, and we can do things very fast. Phase two analyses run in parallel, and they take deep analyses or deep dives into the data and often involve chart review. These are project-specific subsets of sites. Not every site joins the different phase two working group projects. They do deep dives into sites' data with chart review to validate the data and the methods that we're using. And by running on the patient-level data in phase two, we can actually apply machine learning models and do more complex analyses with R. We distribute a Docker image to sites so that even though we're in a federated network, everyone's computing on the same type of environment. This iterative process going back and forth between phase one and phase two allows us to fix data problems, improve our methods, and gain trust in what we're seeing. Here's just some of the key insights we had early on. As you hear later, I think a lot of the other consortia ran into the same kinds of issues. Some of the key outcome measures that we're looking at, such as death, ventilation, and ICU, actually are really difficult to extract from electronic health records. We developed algorithms that use other things like procedures and medications that are good proxies for these. The algorithms we developed at the beginning of our consortium back in spring of 2020 don't work well these days when the disease and the treatments have changed. So we have to continually refine our methods. Lab tests are very difficult. There's a lot of inconsistencies in codes and units, both within hospitals and across countries. So local knowledge is important for that cleanup. And race and ethnicity codes are really complicated, which you may hear about later. In fact, some countries don't even collect this information, and the meaning of race and ethnicity varies by region. As I said, phase one, we take your EHR data. You at your own site will generate these aggregate counts of CSV files that contain different kinds of information in them. They get uploaded, merged centrally, and then we can visualize it and interpret it as a group collectively on our covidclinical.net website. In all of our analyses, we start with the positive PCR test, COVID test admitted patients, but then we have a number of controls. We look at patients who are COVID positive but not admitted, as well as COVID negative cases in the U07.1. Because we have international sites, not every country and institution interprets U07.1 the same, so we have to keep those a little bit separately in our analysis. Is that mentioned in only 4 weeks? Our phase one analyses were able to get the first preprint out looking at laboratory trajectories. In phase two, I mentioned we can do deeper dives into the data using R-strips, extensive QC processes, and manual chart review. Again, even in phase two, we're only sharing aggregate counts and statistics collectively with the group. All the patient level data stays within your institution. There are a number of different phase two working groups and projects. Some of these are looking at refining and validating our methods. Others are looking at understudied, underrepresented populations. We have a number of disease specific working groups, including a neuro, kidney injury, and others. And of course, the big thing everyone's looking at right now is long COVID or post-acute sequelae of COVID-19 in the past.
Griffin, this is your two-minute.
Yes, thank you. Do you wanna take over?
Yeah, sure. So as Griffin mentioned that for most of the processes that we go through, beginning from data harmonization, quality control, and also all the way to the final analysis predictive modeling, we do this in a federated manner. However, much of the process is really a team effort that included many people on the team. And I really feel tremendously privileged to be able to have communications with informatics people who are very familiar with the data, to the analysts and to our clinical expertise to assess the basic interpretation of the result. And here I just gave you a rough, like a diagram, which Griffin has a similar version. I just want to mention that we go through the data harmonization and quality control by looking at the data across the site. So this is one time I really appreciate having data from so many different sites. We can check the data against each other to see what are the patterns that we see across most sites. And we'll notice that some sites have very strange data, which I can show you how that helped us to go through the QC process. After we have the more cleaned version of the data, we start running analysis locally on their data, and then the final aggregated summary data will be sent to a central site most of the time to HMS, and we have analysts working together to perform aggregate analysis such as meta-analysis. But I also want to mention that this kind of model also allows us to do a lot more, such as co-training of the model. Basically, if we are interested in modeling for specific subpopulation, they tend to have small sample size. The structure that we set in place will enable us to do that. And I think one great advantage is that when we perform all these analyses, we have expertise from all the teams to understand, for example, when you see an outlier, is that actually clinically a plausible value, or it's basically just an outlier because the patient in our study cohort is very sick. So the multi-institution and also multinational data also allowed us to do extensive assessment of transportability across different hospital systems and across different nations. Next. So here, I want to show you one example that we had basically average level of total bilirubin across different sites. And this is the y-axis. You can see that most of the sites have average values right around one, for example. And then you can see a few sites, they have average level completely off from the rest of the people. And then you also see occasionally you have dots way up in the sky. And there are basically some we noticed and went back to the local institution and noticed there issues the ETL process. They get some error from the ETL process. And also the implausible values, the trend that's way off from everybody else could be a unit issue that we went back to check. And interestingly, sometimes we notice a difference also because we include pediatric populations. So they sometimes do have certain labs that are different. And another thing I want to mention that having lab results, for example, from different institutions, we also are able to check what's the percentage of patients actually have, for example, CRP measured at baseline. And that allowed us to assess maybe there's a code mapping problem. They actually missed a lot of the codes that can be mapped to CRP. And we did identify such problems and went back to the local site to fix this particular issue. Next. Here is just our general approach for any kind of predictive modeling. We have individual sites that we send the R code, and Griffin mentioned the Docker, and they are able to run most analysis locally, and the summary data will be sent to the central site, and then within the central site, we would do, for example, meta-analysis or co-training. Being able to work together as a team really allows us to go back to the team, to go back to the local site when we see either abnormality of the results, or we actually find certain analysis strategy that we put in place weren't exactly what we thought that they would achieve. So the whole process is iterative, but because we have strong engagement from the local sites, we are able to perform this iteratively and produce the final high quality result to make sure everything is not due to, for example, pure bias or error in the model. And
you have a few minutes remaining.
Yeah, next. So here, I just want to touch upon the last point about the transportability and generalizability. As we all know right now, there's a huge focus about the interpretation of the model as well as the transportability. If you, for example, send a very comprehensive deep learning model to a local site, it's possible that the model learned a local variation that is very specific to the site and may not be transportable to other sites. Having data from so many different healthcare centers allow us to assess this kind of transportability. Here at the right-hand side, I just want to show you that basically each of the row and each of the column represent different site, and the each of the little block represent the model trained in one site that's sent to another site, what's their predictiveness. And you can see actually, because this particular model that we trained are based on a lot of clinical input and analysis that are based on the interpretation of the result, the transportability was actually amazingly good, that even across nation and across different healthcare centers. But having the structure in place, it also does allow us to, for example, train a model that is very specific or ideal for a particular country, let's say France. But they can also leverage data that we have in place in other countries to help them to train their model. I think this is just give you a sense of what kind of analysis or process that we have in place once we have data on the individual level patient.